Welcome students, today we'll talk about breast, which is a very important topic for MBBS level. First we will look at the anatomy. The breast anatomy is very important for you to understand to attempt any MCQ. First we'll start with the basic breast lobular anatomy. I have drawn one small figure which will give you an overview about how the breast unit looks. Now this is a typical picture which is in profile showing the breast with the suspensory ligament of Cooper, which are very important for suspending the breast and giving the pendulous nature. Then microscopically, if you take further cuts, if you can see, this is the presentation of the breast lobule. This is a nipple areola complex. It is inside taken with the duct, that is a lactiferous duct, which ends up and forms a small globular sinus, which is called as lactiferous sinus, which continues inside as lactiferous ducts. On either sides, it offshoots and forms various alveoli, and in this epithelium of this alveoli forms the breast milk. Now this entire structural unit is present, and this is portrayed in a magnified form. There are hundreds of such units available in human breast. Once you understand this basic concept, it becomes easier for us to discuss further about anatomy and various physiological changes that occur in human breast. Now, as you know, this is a basic structural unit, and approximately 100 of such lobules are present in human breast. And these lactiferous ducts, which I have already depicted, are approximately 15 to 20 in number. The ligament of Cooper are the ligaments of suspension. Nipple area complex forms a very important structural unit. Lymphatics will also play an important role, which I will show to you in a subsequent image. Lymphatics play very important role in tumor dissemination and for various pathology manifestations. Importance of knowing the lymphatics is the lymph node or the first lymph node that is getting involved in any pathology or particularly a malignancy is considered as a sentinel node. Now what is sentinel? Sentinel means like a guard. That node guards the entire lymphatic channel drainage from that particular area. So it's very important that the first node one needs to examine very meticulously. Now we'll proceed to one more important topic, that is the abnormal discharges. Now the discharges are forming one of the important presenting feature in human breast. As you're aware, many of our patients, they come to us with various discharges. They are very worried about what discharge they are having and what is the clinical importance of that. So as a clinician, we should be well aware of what are the possibilities one can get with various discharges coming from the nipple areola complex. The commonest what we see is a clear and serous discharge that is seen in various physiological conditions, because I have already told you that breast is a dynamic structure. It is an important anatomical as well as physiological unit of human body. So various physiological changes, as the girl will attend menarche, as will go through the various phases of menstruation and childbirth, there will be changes and various manifestations will be seen accordingly. So clear discharge or a little bit of serous discharge is seen sometimes in just various physiological changes or sometimes in fibrocystic disease. The most common discharge, of course, is a milk discharge. That is not a discharge per se, it's a secretion which is a physiological secretion and which happens during the phase of lactation in woman's life. However, milk can also be discharged in some other scenarios, like some endocrine abnormalities or aberrations such as hypothyroidism and sometimes some pituitary tumors. The other common discharges what we know are the blood discharge, that is sanguineous discharge, which is typically seen in duct ectasia, duct papillomas, and malignancy, that is the carcinoma of breast. Black or green discharge can be seen in duct ectasia plus various complications related to it. Purulent discharge or pus discharge is evident with abscess formation, or it shows some infection in the breast unit. Now, from surface sometimes it can discharge, that is from skin sometimes it can lead to discharge. It occurs in various superficial skin conditions like Paget's disease, that is the superficial manifestations of underlying malignancy, skin eczema, that is eczematization of skin due to applying various irritant solutions, irritant creams, or during the phase of lactation can occur, and chancre, that is a syphilitic chancre, that can occur. The treatment for various abnormal nipple discharges will vary from conservative line to a definitive line. Sometimes conditions like skin eczema can just settle with taking out the root cause plus local ointments which are soothing to the skin. Then the underlying conditions like hypothyroidism or some pituitary tumor or some other breast abnormalities can be handled, and that will take care of the things. The treatment that is a definitive treatment is microdoquectomy, that is the excision of the entire unit. As we are already aware that this particular unit that is causing the problem, we need to remove this particular portion of the unit that is considered as breast lobule, and we call it as microdoquectomy, that is the excision and removal of this particular affected unit, not all units, maybe one or two units. That's a specialized surgery. Sometimes in some situations there is a possibility that we have to do cone excision. In cone excision, as you are aware, though I have magnified it, if you see, I will draw one more picture which will give you a better idea that it actually is a cone formation. Now in this figure particularly, this particular affected zone or a wedge, what I have removed or what we will remove, is considered as a cone excision, as a definitive measure or treatment for removal of various types of abnormal breast discharges. So this is about the breast discharges. Commonest thing one can ask in MCQ is about the blood discharge, that is a duct ectasia, which is the commonest, or it can be in duct papilloma. Important for you to understand that milk is the most common discharge or secretion that occurs from the nipple areolar complex. That is the most important, that milk and lactation is normal. So while answering any questions, don't forget that normal physiology comes first, then the aberrations. We now move on to other benign conditions. There are congenital and acquired. So we'll start first with the congenital conditions. Now this will vary from the number of structure, internal changes, and various other abnormalities. So we'll go and see one by one. First is the amasia, that is the absence of entire breast altogether from the chest wall. Now this is seen either in isolation, means unilateral, or very very rarely bilateral. Now in this scenario, when the disease is bilateral, we call it as a Poland's syndrome, in which it means there is an amasia, that is absence of breast structure altogether, plus absence of sternal portion of pectoralis major muscle. After absence, the next thing that comes is the polymasia, that is presence of accessory or extra breast unit on the chest wall. Commonest site is the axilla. Ipsilateral axilla forms the most common site. As you are aware, there is a mammary line that runs from our body. It goes from the axilla, it goes from the normal breast unit, and it goes till the lower abdomen. Now along this mammary line, which I will just show you in one small diagram, this dotted line emphasizes the mammary line coming from embryonic region. Now usually, as we see, this is the commonest area of nipple areolar complex. as we are aware. So when we are looking at this, one should be aware that there can be possibility of having accessory nipples or some accessory small breast globule like this in the axilla, which is a commonest site, plus at other sites also. So it can be either in isolation, that is the nipple areola, or it can be complete breast unit totally, so polymasia. Then there is one more entity, that is the mastitis of infants. It is also called as witch's milk. What happens usually after the childbirth, there is a lot of hormonal changes that occur in maternal body. Now during this there is stimulation by the fetal breast by the maternal prolactin. This particularly gives rise to witch's milk. So sometimes if you see a newborn, sometimes during the cleaning of the baby, one can actually express few drops of milk from the nipple areola complex from the baby. But that is not to get worried or get astonished. It is a normal physiological process. And lastly, sometimes there can be diffuse hypertrophy. It can be again unilateral or bilateral. After this congenital conditions benign, we'll next go to the breast injuries. Now injuries also form a very common part or common entity when you are discussing about the benign breast conditions. Commonest thing that what we encounter is a breast hematoma formation. Or when there is a blunt trauma to the breast unit, there can be momentary collection of blood beneath the suspensory ligament, and it eventually seals off and gives rise to a small hematoma formation. Now this hematoma can eventually increase or it can get absorbed in the body as per the patient's natural response. But if there is a hematoma, there is a chance that it can get infected. So we need to treat it accordingly if it is painful. If it is not painful, if it is not causing any problem to the patient, then we need not worry about it. Second thing is the traumatic fat necrosis, again related to injury. What happens is when we transfer the energy during any injury, there is, as you are aware, that this breast unit is a modified sweat gland, and there is a lot of fat that is present in this during the parenchyma. So because of which there is ischemic fat necrosis that occurs after transfer of energy to the breast unit, and that what causes the changes. Now these changes have been categorized into two things. One is acute or chronic. In acute, there can be severe pain to the patient, and there will be areas of blackening and some discoloration. In chronic, it goes unnoticed initially. Eventually, after some days, patient may complain of some pain with the breast unit. In both the conditions, the treatment is conservative. You need not do any surgical intervention for the patient. We'll now move on to inflammation. Inflammation forms a very important role in understanding various benign breast pathologies. First, we'll see acute mastitis. Now, as I have shown in this slide, it will give you an overview of what we are talking. Initially, the commonest organism that is encountered is Staphylococcus aureus. 50% infants harbor it in the nasopharynx, that is the upper airway, from the second day onwards after the birth. This is a common practice that what we have seen. We will not blame it to the mothers, but it happens that during cleaning of baby's mouth, it sometimes goes a little rough, and because of which there are small abrasions and small cuts that happen with baby's mouth. Now these cuts are very prone to lodge these microorganisms and hence carry out the infection. Now the child, when suckles on the breast, the infection is transmitted and proceeded to the breast unit. Now as you know, aware of, when a newborn, when initially suckles on the breast, it adjusts how he or she, that child, will suckle from that particular mother, and it will take at least 2-3 days time during which the baby will start suckling very nicely onto his mother. So during this time, there is a transmission of this infection from baby's mouth to the breast of mother, and which happens exactly during the acute mastitis. So this is a totally preventable condition. Second thing what we observe is inflammation that is leading to cellulitis. Now this is when happens when the mother or the patient ignores the inflammation and it eventually lands up in abscess formation if the treatment is not taken in course of time. Cellulitis can be halted with good antibiotics, but if not treated, it goes on to abscess formation. Now, breast is one of a common area in the body where if abscess is formed, it will not show a typical sign of fluctuation, which is a hallmark of any abscess. If it is a superficial abscess, it will be quite evident, but in breast, it is not. So, when the clinician notices that this particular patient is likely to be suffering from a breast abscess, one needs to intervene as soon as possible. That is, the incision and drainage needs to be done as early as possible. If the overzealous use of antibiotics results in what we know is antibioma formation, that the entire abscess cavity becomes a sterile cavity and it converts it into just a sterile big cavity, which is still painful and we need to intervene. Next are various other forms, that are the subacute form, chronic form, depending on in which stage the patient is presenting to us. Tuberculosis, one of the most common disease in our country, also affects breast. Cooper first identified it and labeled it, this entity, and gave a scientific paper on it, but still a little rarer condition. Other rarer forms are actinomycosis and syphilis. There is one special entity, that is the Mondor's disease, which happens. It is nothing but a thrombophlebitis of superficial veins of breast and anterior chest wall. It is rarely seen going on to the axilla and the arm. Next, we'll come to an important entity, that is the ANDI, that is aberrations of normal development and involution. It goes in four stages. First is a stage of cyst formation. Second is a stage of fibrosis. Third is a stage of hyperplasia, and fourth is a stage of papillomatosis. Clinically, such patients will present to us with either lump in the breast or they will present with pain in the breast. These both conditions are very, very peculiar and very important for us to detect and to treat. Treatment, when we are anticipating any treatment for such ANDI, we should know that it is aberration and need not be every time a disease. So that is what matters most. Most important is one needs to think that in elderly female coming to us with ANDI, we have to rule out malignancy, that is carcinoma. Second thing, many of these patients will settle with simple good reassurance. Nothing much is required. These people are extremely anxious and they are worried what is happening to their body, why there is sudden pain in the breast, why there is sudden cyst formation, why there are sudden changes that is occurring, which is not known to them. So we have to just calm down the patient. That's most important. A good clinician maintains a pain chart. Now, what is this pain chart? Pain chart is nothing but a visual analog score. There is a chart which goes from 0 to 10, and you have to ask the patient that please grade your pain, whether it is 0, that is a nothing, 5, average, that you can just bear or it will just pass off, or 10, it is extremely excruciating pain and the patient cannot bear it, needs to take some treatment. So depending on that, there will be cyclical fluctuation in the breast unit as per the menstruation. So because of which there will be cyclical fluctuations in the pain chart. So as you are aware that these are the cyclical changes and nothing abnormality, so you have to reassure the patient and maybe give a little bit symptomatic treatment. There are drugs available such as evening primrose oil, danazol, tamoxifen, oral contraceptive pills that are the hormonal balancing, prolactin inhibitors such as bromocriptine, and vitamin E, that is alpha tocopherol. All these drugs form very, very important role in a conservative line of management. Out of this, danazol is used most commonly. Tamoxifen we do not use so commonly. Vitamin E, yes, we use very commonly, that is alpha tocopherol. Next, we'll see the most benign common lump formation in the female breast, that is the fibroadenoma. 90% of the patients who come to us, they present to us with this particular entity, which is a painless small nodule in the breast, which is freely mobile in the breast parenchyma. Now, when we examine these patients, it is firm, it will yield lower pressure and it will be initially painless. Eventually it will become painful. Usually they are limited to single, that is solitary. Very rarely it can be multiple. There is something known as giant fibroadenoma, in which the maximum dimension exceeds 5 cm for the fibroadenoma, and which occurs during puberty. For fibroadenoma, FNAC, that is a fine needle aspiration cytology, is the gold standard investigation to diagnose the condition. A good clinician can diagnose it clinically, but still, in nowadays of medico-legal era, we should be well-versed with the basic investigation that will support our diagnosis. Remember, these investigations are not there to make the diagnosis, they are to support your clinical finding. So you should be clinically sound and perfect, so you can actually challenge some investigations. So FNAC is the investigation of choice. In all these fibroadenomas, you need to do excision because there are nodules or lumps that are already formed. So it won't just dissolve with medicines. One needs to differentiate it from fibroadenosis. Now, what is fibroadenosis? It is a form in which there is diffuse momentary hypertrophy and pain in the breast unit, which happens during the menstruation, and it subsides after the menstruation. That is what is most important. And for fibroadenosis, you need not give any special treatment. Just support your treatment, good reassurance to the patient, and a little bit of pain management. Overall, fibroadenoma and adenosis, both benign conditions, will carry excellent prognosis. Next, we'll go to one tumor, that is the phyloid's tumor, which will be a borderline area between the benign breast and the malignancy. Now, phyloid's tumor, the other names for this particular entity is the cysticercoma phyloides or serocystic disease of Brody, because Benjamin Brody first gave a scientific account of this condition. Usually occurs above the age of 45 years. It is usually a very large tumor that is present in the breast parenchyma. The size may vary from 2 cm to 5 cm to sometimes even 7 cm. Why we call it as sarcoma initially? It was actually a misnomer. That is why we do not use it anymore. We just call it as phyloid's tumor. Now, this sarcomatous changes were observed because microscopically, if you see, it used to give us a leaf-like pattern appearance. So that's why the previous clinicians and histologists gave a term that is called as cysticercoma phyloides. But now, with better understanding of the disease, we consider it as a phyloid's tumor. Small tumors, which are up to 2 to 5 cm, can be cured with simple excision and complete enucleation. Now, in this, what we do, we remove the entire capsule along with the nodule. For a large tumor, recurrent tumor, and for a malignant potential or a suspicion of malignancy, what we do is a simple mastectomy. That is what now WHO recommends. So just to summarize, in this benign conditions, what we have seen are the various abnormal breast discharges. Second thing, we have seen either lump formation. We have seen various aberrations from the physiology, that is the aberrations of normal development and involution. So one should be well versed what physiological changes occur to the breast unit and what aberrations to understand. It's very important for you to understand the basic normal thing, to understand or to pick up what is abnormal. And lastly, majority of this patient actually will be better with simple reassurance, because they are extremely anxious because of any small changes that occur in their body. Every time you did not opt for surgery, these things can be managed conservatively very nicely. So I think it will be very helpful for you during your exam preparation. Thank you.